So digital transformation has become a reality in our country. And indeed, we have the Digital India movement, or the campaign that was started by the government of India 6 years ago, has now come to real fruition as we see digital transformation being adopted in each and every sphere of our country. Whether it is small businesses, startups, corporates, everybody is seeing digital transformation landscape becoming part of the digital transformation landscape. And today we are here talking to Mrs. Arundhati Bhattacharya, who's going to share with us as to what is really the setup or this landscape getting towards, and how is it that we have reached here, and where are we going forward when it comes to the digital adoption in this country. So welcome, Mrs. Arundhati. We warmly welcome you to the Tech and Innovation Summit by Entrepreneur, and we're looking forward to having your thoughts in the next few minutes about what do you feel the tech transformation and the journey is going to be all about. Certainly, the pandemic, while it's, of course, given us enough nightmares and made us sit at home, but I think it's also done the work of many, many decades in just about 1 year, where there has been natural transition for businesses to move towards digital, for people to adopt digital very quickly. So what is your thought on how is the digital transformation really going, and what is it that you look forward in by 2025 to be the digital landscape map of India?
So first of all, thank you very much. And I'm extremely honored to be on this platform today. Regarding digital transformation, you know, it's obviously migrated from being something that was good to have to must have.
Sure.
And it is true that, you know, the work that we probably would have done over a period of 3-4 years is actually now being done over a period of few months. Because this is something that I had talked about a number of years back, maybe 6-7 years back. And I had said even at that time that, you know, unless you have a very strong technology backbone and a very strong digital offering, there is no way that we are going to survive into the next 10-20 years. It is especially true for India, I think. And it's true for India merely because, you know, the numbers of people that we have and the income levels of people that we have, it's very difficult for us to deliver all services through the brick and mortar route. Right. And the brick and mortar route also has an issue in the sense that it doesn't leave the kind of audit trails that you want it to leave. Okay. Now, digital is something that actually enables you to deliver services at far lower cost with audit trails and with personalization, because again, your demands will be very different from my demands. Okay. Your requirements will be very different from mine. Now, how do you ensure that the offering that you bring is something that is suitable to you, and the offering that you bring me is something that's suitable for me? This kind of personalization, this kind of, you know, individual attention that is required to be given is not possible in the physical space. You can only do that for large customers. You cannot do it for the smaller customers. And if you look at India, India is all about the small person. You know, the much of the entire population rests on the bottom of the pyramid. And if you're looking at that, you know, digital and technology are the only things that are going to enable us to have a more, you know, equal society. And I give a lot of emphasis on equality, on ensuring that nobody is left behind, merely because the tensions that are caused in a social society where, you know, you have the haves and the have-nots, and the positions are bifurcating, or, you know, they are becoming, the gap is becoming wider. If that happens, then actually speaking, that society is bound to have a lot of issues, is bound to have a lot of unrest. So for us, you know, if we look at it, you know, just imagine the area of education. I think in the area of education, if you see the quality of education you get in the rural areas and the quality of education you get in the urban areas, there's a big difference, right? However, today, because of digital, the same quality of education can now be delivered even to the rural areas. There is, of course, a need for infrastructure in order to ensure that this material that is now available and capable of being delivered is actually delivered. For that, you need the broadband communication, you need tablets in the hand of every student. But the fact of the matter is that the solution is now in our hands.
Correct.
And we know that even as we give the right kind of education to our urban population, we can replicate the same thing for the rural population, that they need not really fall behind. Okay. As I said, you know, there is the need for this infrastructure that needs to become much better for the country. And NASSCOM as a body has been interacting with the government, and the government has been reiterating its commitment in ensuring that this infrastructure growth is really, you know, is really going to be pushed and is going to pick up pace. And as that happens, many of the social services, whether it be education, whether it be health, whether it be just, you know, the delivery of subsidies, the delivery of, you know, minimum kind of, you know, support systems, all of these you will find will become far better in quality and quantity. And therefore, I think, you know, if you look at what has happened in the pandemic, what has happened, of course, is extremely sad. Frankly speaking, it's not happened in 100 years, and I hope it will not happen in the next 200 or maybe more years, okay? But the fact remains that, you know, while there has been a terrible experience that we've had, on the reverse side of it, there has been benefits, and yes, these are those benefits.
Absolutely. I think in that sense, if some good has come out of the pandemic, it is the digital transformation and its adoption in the country. Now, ma'am, I understand that digital transformation, while it requires a lot of technology infrastructure to go inside in an organization or in a state or in a village, wherever it is going to happen and bring a change. But also it's about human change and people adopting to technology in a way that they feel that it's a part of their life. So particularly, where do you feel, in what sectors, in what areas in this country do you feel that this human change has come to happen? Together with the technology infrastructure that is being laid out.
So I think, you know, EdTech has taken to it very well. So for that matter is on the health services. If sure. you look at, for instance, the COVID app, it sort of gives you the understanding of how much we have, how far we have gone, because the COVID app is extremely easy to register on. You can get your appointments on it. Right. For your vaccinations, you can get your certifications from it on vaccinations. It has a QR code. So, you know, you take a printout of it or you just show it on your mobile phone and it can be immediately validated to see whether the thing is right or not. So, you know, health also has taken very well to this particular activity. But if you look at all of the sectors, so whether it be manufacturing, whether it be retail, whether it be media and communications, I really can't find a single sector where, you know, this has really not been adopted. I have a 92-year-old aunt at home, and she is a person who obviously, you know, isn't able to go around much. So the newspaper is her lifeline. Today, she reads 3 newspapers on the net, okay? So something that I would not even have believed possible, maybe even a few months back. Because, right. you know, we stopped taking physical newspapers on account of fears of infection and things like that. And she couldn't stay without her morning newspaper. So we taught her to read it on the computer. And she does it now completely. I mean, she's quite independent about it and she reads it. And in fact, she finds it better because, you know, she can make the fonts bold enough for her to read it very comfortably. So, you know, the change that has happened, whether it be for the youngsters or it be for the older people, it's enormous. And I really can't think of any particular sector that has not benefited from it. It's very difficult to think of a sector that's not benefited from it. Even for that matter, I'm on the board of a very large company, and they have very large manufacturing facilities. Now, what do? They even use things like drones now for surveillance to ensure that all of the equipment is working fine, that there are no fires or no, you know, indications of anything going wrong. Similarly, you know, if you look at the oil and gas companies today, for instance, they can have entire 3D virtualizations of their platforms. And those 3D virtualizations actually give you signals from ahead of time in case right. something is malfunctioning, so that you know that particular stuff can be closed down and you can carry out all of the repairs. Even the repairs, for that matter, can be done virtually. And as you know, we are the software as a service company. During this period when we were working from home, and we are continuing to work from home, we have got into new negotiations, closed deals, actually implemented stuff, and gone alive with those clients remotely. Everything has been done remotely. So it's been an entirely new world that we have discovered that we can actually do, which, you know, was never sort of even imagined earlier, merely because there was no need for it. But now that the need has occurred, we find that so much more can be done. And if you can do so much more remotely, you can imagine what happens in the far reaches of our country. If we only have the communication network going and the devices in the hands of the people, so much more can be delivered to them than what is being delivered today.
Sure, absolutely, ma'am. And ma'am, given the fact that, you know, so many companies are adopting tech on the business side, small companies, corporates, startups, you know, how do you envision the future of enterprise tech in India? How do you see it growing in the coming years at NASSCOM? How are they envisioning the industry will grow as an enterprise tech in the coming years? And particularly what areas? I mean, you know, at Salesforce, of course, SaaS is important. But then there's so many technologies out there which are important for businesses. So any forecast that has been created towards it?
No, forecasts, of course, are there. I wouldn't be able to give you the numbers straight away off the bat. But, you know, there is going to be a huge amount of change, especially on account of use of AI, on use of ML, that is machine learning, use of robotics, use of quantum computing, use of things like blockchain. So all of these things are stuff that are definitely going to make a very large difference to the way we do things from the way we do things now. If you're looking at enterprise tech obviously is already changing pretty swiftly, merely because they are now understanding that they need to be omnichannel. Right. You cannot only be either physical or digital. And I think there, at least in India, where you have a pretty large number of people who are still, you know, not all that digital savvy, and yet you have this younger generation that seem to be wired for digital. Even if they've not been taught it, they can immediately, you know, they just sort of, they are very intuitive about it.
Right.
And I keep giving this example that, you know, if I bring a new phone home, my daughter is able to find out far more functionalities on that phone than I ever will. She does it within hours. I take months and I still don't know those functionalities, right?
Sure.
So I've been using Google Meet now for the last 16, 17 months. And then just the other day, she told me, why don't you whiteboard? And I said, how do you do it? And she taught me. Now, nobody's taught her Google Meet.
Right.
She's again learned on her own. And right. they do it because they have some intuitive capabilities of doing it. But because we have this very large proportion of the older generation like me, you will not be seeing, in India at least, a total shift to digital.
Right.
It will have to be a kind of a phygital kind of a presence where there is a physical as well as a digital presence. And depending upon times of when we can approach the physical for what purpose and when digital is good enough or when it's not possible to do the physical, every enterprise now has understood that they need to own the customer. Okay,
right.
Owning the customer, and not only the customer, even on the supply side, they need to have a number of channels to approach their supply side, as well as the dealership side, as well as the customer side. Having a single channel attached to any particular vertical is not going to work. And that being the case, enterprise is something that is really metamorphosing very, very quickly as they shift towards ensuring that they are as good in the digital space as they are in the physical space. So you will see, you know, even in retail, many of the very large retailers who are totally physical now are becoming, they're having their own digital channels. Absolutely. And those, some of those digital channels, the experience is really out of the world. It's very good, yes, the kind of experience that they are trying to give. So the fact is, they understand that, you know, you can't close down all the stores. You don't need to. On the other hand, you also need to have this other outlet, because at any point of time, you will have different classes of customers, different environments, which you will need to continue to address in order to ensure that your business is not going through dips and ups, and, you know, so that you have a consistent growth in your business as you would have in any normal times.
Sure. And ma'am, you know, with the adoption of digital transformation that is taking place, we are also seeing another situation, which is a tech talent crunch that is coming to happen in India. There is, you know, and with SMEs, corporates, everybody sort of looking for more tech talent. And of course, you know, enterprise tech itself looking for more tech talent. There is overall a great crunch, at least in the short term, that we are beginning to see. How do we address that as a nation? Because, you know, now that we are stepping forward, we don't want to step backward just because, you know, there are not enough hands who can manage it. So what could be a solution to this?
So, you know, we are already working pretty closely with the National Skill Development Mission. We are also working with various other academic institutions. NASSCOM has something going on the skills side, where again, we are partnering. So most of these companies, the tech companies, they have their own platforms, which enable skilling in a very gamified manner. So it can be done from within an organization. It can even be done from outside. And many of these are free for people to use. But it is a fact that there is a terrible tech crunch and the tech skills crunch, I'll say. And this is something that needs to be addressed as quickly as possible. Mm-hmm. See, just as China was the manufacturing backbone of the world, India actually can be the talent backbone for the world.
Correct.
We have enough, close to 1 million people graduating as engineers every single year. There is no other company, no other country, maybe other than China, that's doing that. Now, out of these, quite a large number of them can easily be reskilled in the right kind of technology that is required for this digitization effort to go forward. Also, you know, in respect of your own employees, we have found that it is 6 times cheaper to reskill an employee rather than to sort of do a lateral hire.
Right.
So, you know, within the companies themselves, there is a lot of skilling efforts that are going on. So we have huge amount of enablement exercises that we do on a monthly, quarterly basis to ensure that our workforce is kept up to speed. At the same time, we are working with the ecosystem, because today, you know, a lot of people are hiring. People who are implementing these applications, they are hiring. People who are actually buying these applications, they are hiring, because they want to have centers of excellence within their IT departments so as to be able to make the best use of the applications that they are actually putting out money for. Similarly, you know, companies like ours, that's the OEMs, they are hiring. So there is a lot of hiring going on for research and development, for engineering, for even for support functions.
Right.
Because after you've taken something, you know, you do need to have a support function to troubleshoot any issues that might come up, and issues come up all the time, you know that.
Correct.
So, you know, you need people for the support function. You also need people. The tech industry itself is finding so much of a requirement that, you know, you need tech people even for the selling motion. So even the pre-sales piece needs technology-oriented and enabled people, so that, you know, they can actually demo to you, put together demonstrations as to what this particular application can do for you. So there are requirements at various stages of the entire cycle for tech-skilled people. And there is a crunch for that. There's no doubt about it. But I think, you know, it's also a huge opportunity because none of this is really rocket science.
Right.
It is, if you have already been a techie, upgrading yourself is not a problem.
Right.
Even if you have not been a techie, today, the way the technology is happening, you know, there are various, as I said, various kinds of jobs that you can take up in the tech space. And not all of them needs you to code. In fact, today, most of the platforms are click, not code. So they are all no code, low code platforms.
Right, right.
So to that extent, you know, people from other areas can also get in and actually start understanding how these whole thing, this entire thing works. You know, me, for instance, even at my age, I have come to work for a tech company with a Finns background. I don't have a tech background at all. But at the end of the day, there are people that are coming from various other areas, and they are coming into the technology industry because they find it interesting and because it is not all that difficult for you to at least understand the rudiments of what is being done. And I would say that, you know, for all those people out there who feel that, you know, the end of the world is coming, it is time for them to reskill themselves. Right. Reskilling is not such a difficult matter. It can be done. Similarly, for the youngsters who are coming up, they need to be upskilled with the kind of skill, you know, the kind of things that we are looking for in the market. And again, that means that we have to work in partnership with government, with industry, with academia in order to get there.
Sure. And ma'am, you know, on a larger level, how do you sort of advise a company which is getting into digital transformation mode to, you know, how do they plan this transformation? I mean, you know, if one was to just sort of give an overview about a digital transformation roadmap for an organization, which is, let's say, a mid-sized, somewhere between a mid-sized to a large-sized organization, how should they sort of do it in the right way? What should be there? They need to do it seamlessly because obviously they need to manage the consumer experience in a digital environment with their physical environment. And then they need to sort of also budget things right. You know, what kind of cost for tech talent or for the actual technology proposition that they need to put in place. So how is it that they should plan themselves better?
So, you know, there is a McKinsey study, and this was, of course, I think, just as the pandemic was starting, that said that almost 80% of companies had started the digital transformation, but only 3% had finished it.
Right.
Okay. So that shows you how difficult it is to do this transformation unless you have the right methodology for doing it. Now, I would say one of the first things that is required is the CEO buy-in. Unless the C-suite is completely bought in and completely committed to this exercise, it's very difficult to get it done. The first and foremost is the CEO buy-in, the C-suite buy-in. But once you have that, you've then got to extend the buy-in to the rest of the organization.
Right.
Because unless the rest of the organization also welcomes the change, because it is a change. It is a change of humongous proportions for very many organizations. Now, unless and until you have an open mind towards the change, you are then actually, you know, sort of pushing against the tide. And that's right. Not easy. Okay, sure. That's not easy to do. So if you have tailwinds instead of headwinds, then, you know, getting there becomes much faster. The second thing I think that you need to understand is how digitally mature is your organization. If you see, the goal could be the same for everybody, but you may need to climb 2 steps to get to the goal, or you may need to climb 20 steps to get to the goal. Correct. You have to be realistic about how many steps you need to climb. And then, you know, you need to set your expectations accordingly.
Right.
You will still get to the goal. But instead of getting to it at one leap, which a company that has 2 steps to climb can do, if you are at the one of those companies that has 20 steps to climb, you need to break it up into pieces to see what needs to get delivered at which stage, and then still do the transformation, but do it in a much more orderly manner, and do it in a manner where your expectations are not getting constantly sort of, bellied, or constantly, not met, so that, a disappointment sets in. That should not happen. So when we are taking up a project, it is important both for the customer and for the seller to do a very clear understanding of where the customer is, and then what will be the effort required in order to get to another place.
Right.
That is the third thing that is very important to do. And the last but not least thing, I think, is the ability to really do the change management. Because, the implementations of technology is not really a big challenge. It can happen. But once it has happened, if I don't have adoption, then the whole thing is wasted.
Stickiness
so I,
is
need, I need adoption. And yeah. For adoption, what I need is for people not only to have the buy-in, but also to take the trouble to understand how to do it and then get on with doing it. Right. Initially, it may not be very comfortable. Okay, it never is. But then subsequently, once you have got over that first inertia, as per the laws of physics, the inertia is something when the car starts moving, it needs maximum power to get to the first movement. After that, movement becomes much easier.
Right. Okay?
It is the same with these transformations. The first move out always needs far more effort. Once you're past the first block, thereafter you will see things falling in place. So if you are looking at what should be the roadmap for a company in order to do this, they first and foremost must understand their requirements. Secondly, they must be convinced that, yes, this is the right way to go about it. Thirdly, they must create buy-in from the entire organization. And fourth, they must do change management in a proper way. Only when this happens, then only you will find, successful implementations. And successful implementations are always joint efforts. They are not efforts only by the company or the customer, or only by the seller, or only by the implementer. They are all joint pursuits, with everybody understanding that this is the goal and this is how we get to it. If it is done in that manner, there is no reason why there should be any disappointment.
Sure. No, ma'am, that's so well put. And I think it's a journey that one has to do in a digital transformation. And therefore, it's important that it's a together exercise instead of then first doing it and then trying people to put them on the job and getting them be woven in into the system. Thank you so much for talking to us, ma'am. It's been such a wonderful session with you, and so many ideas and so many takeaways that have come out of this session for people or organizations who are today looking to get into technology, and for startups who are there and growing out there. In fact, subsequently, we're going to move into the Entrepreneur Awards, where we'll recognize some young startups and organizations who are doing really well. So any message that you want to give to these?
Yeah, of course. I think the startups are now turning out to be the backbone of the country.
Surely.
I really and truly get excited at some of these startups and the ideas that they have brought to the table, the amount of work that they have done in order to actually, get that idea to be live. Because, I believe that the law is very clear. That is, if for an entrepreneur, if there is anything that can go wrong, will go wrong.
Sure.
The fact that all of these people have overcome that and they are still here and they are qualifying for these prizes, it just tells me that, these people are outstanding guys, outstanding people. And the thing is, they are not only creating value for themselves, they're creating value for the company, for the country. They're creating value for others. So to a great extent, I would say that, they are really and truly contributing to the making of our nation. Our nation is one such where you have to be, self-sufficient. You have to be there, out there, getting your own thing done, because there is not too much of a support system to enable you to do it. The fact that these guys have been able to really, still fructify the ideas they had and put the business on the ground, they need huge congratulations for it. So my congratulations to all of the people who actually won the prizes, but also to the people who competed for them. It's important to compete, and even they are creating great value in the ecosystem, though they may not be actually recognized by prizes over here, but they're recognized by society as doing something which is really very important. So my best, very best wishes to all of them.
Thank you very much, ma'am. And it's been wonderful speaking to you here today.
Thank you.
Thank you.